Okay, Wang Shu, happy birthday, Wang Shu. A very important Chinese architect. And let me read a little bit about him. Wang Shu, born November 4th, 1963, is a Chinese architect based in Hangzhou, Zhejiang province. Sorry for the pronunciation. He is the Dean of the School of Architecture of the China Academy of Art. With his practice partner and wife, Lu Wenyu, he founded the firm Amateur Architecture Studio. In 2012, Wang became the first Chinese citizen to win the Pritzker Prize. You know, it's said the first Chinese citizen, because Ian Pei was also Chinese, but not a Chinese citizen any longer, or not only. He received the Pritzker Prize much earlier. Anyway, the world's top prize in architecture. The award was the subject of some controversy, since the Pritzker Committee did not also award Lu Wenyu, his wife, an architectural partner, despite their years of collaboration. Yes, I would agree. It was unfair, actually unacceptable, because the works they did together, But it seems the Pritzker Foundation and you know, the people responsible there are not yet sufficiently opened to a certain kind of fairness. Anyway, amateur architecture, what a beautiful name for a studio. I really love it. You know, in a world pretentiously called professional, here are brilliant architects who proved themselves and who had the modesty to call their studio amateur architecture. Bravo to them. Here they are. I think they are beautiful, although they don't look, maybe he doesn't look very happy. She looks a little bit more proud, but let us, and here we see Anda in the foreground, a special structure. Yes, they experiment a lot, and a very modest atelier. I don't even know. I mean, I imagine they have collaborators, but it's also possible they don't. I don't know how they work. I didn't see working drawings by Wang Shu. I only saw sketches with pencil in book notes. Who knows? Maybe in China it's possible to build buildings, even large buildings, based on hand-drawn sketches. I don't know. The truth is, I don't know. But well, they have here, I see the ghost, the shadow of a computer, but mainly he's known for doing handmade drawings. And we are going to see some of those drawings. Okay. Hello, Mr. Wang Shu. You know, in China, the first name is actually the family name, and the last name is the first name. So his family name is Wang, not Shu. Okay, here they are again. Bravo to them. Maybe a love story. I imagine a love story which culminated professionally in a beautiful amateur architecture. I like this picture of him. He doesn't look like a star, does he? I mean, he got the Pritzker Prize, but he's just a human being on this earth trying to achieve his best potential and to not insult the earth. Here they are. And looking at this picture, I do have the feeling that she's a very important presence in his life, and also in his and their work. Okay, here they are again. I think here they are here. It's possible that they are the Venice Biennial where he contributed, and we are going to see his work some years ago at the Venice Biennial. I also think, I'm not totally sure, but I'm almost 95% sure that when he received the Pritzker Prize, Zaha Hadid was in the jury. And if this is so, and I believe it is so, This says a lot about Zaha, because his work is very, very, or their work is very, very different from her work. But, and I don't think it's an accident. I'm sure that if she was in the jury, and I think she was, in 2012, I think he received the Pritzker Prize, says something about her objectivity. You know, even if the work was very different from hers, she still promoted it or said yes. Okay, Wang Shu drawings. That's how he draws. I mean, you know, I don't know if the buildings he built or the buildings they built and build are based, essentially on handmade drawings of this nature. You'll see also some plans, but I never saw, although it's hard for me to believe that, you know, at this point, China is a sophisticated society, a developed society. They build, large buildings sometimes based just on essentially sketches, but he draws very well. He draws even on walls, as you can see here in 2018. What you see here in the sketch on the wall, you see something unusual, which probably happens only in China. You know, it's a passageway over the roofs of the buildings, and you are going to see pictures with this strangeness, where you see people actually walking on the roofs. And I imagine it's a very interesting experience. I never went through something like this, but I imagine I don't know exactly why the Chinese do this. I only saw this happening in China, he has at least one project or two projects with something like this. He actually draws here, I don't know to call it an axonometric drawing or whatever it is of one of his buildings. Other sketches. And that's how he draws. There are books published with his drawings, and I like his drawings very much. Yes, I advocate the digital culture. You saw plenty of it the other day when I talked about Godzilla architecture. But I also admire very much good hand drawings, handmade drawings. They're very modest, they are illustrative. It's possible that in China, because he advocates spontaneity, there is some kind of an ad hoc architecture that he's able to build. And maybe for that kind of architecture, it's possible to, produce such drawings and just go with them on the building site, and that's it. He also collects a lot of material from demolitions, and then he reuses them. So he was and is one of the architects truly involved with what we call sustainability, with reuse, recycle, and so on. He did this for a good number of years. But the reusing materials from the past has another aspect to it. It's also about connecting with what we call the past. And in this way, the past didn't pass or doesn't pass. So it's on the spiral of time, Wang Shu and his wife, they connect, they continue. But there is also a break, and the break is because of some innovations or some unconventional parts of the work, of which you will become aware very soon. And it's very possible that a good work is able to connect, to unite what we call tradition with what we call innovation, to have both. Look at these plans, I wonder if you do a diploma work in a school of architecture like this, you would most surely be dismissed. But here is a Pritzker Prize laureate who, that's how he works. You see, I was talking about continuity and break. Well, here is the break. I mean, literally, here is the break. And it's maybe not very apparent in the elevation, but this eventful break is most of the time, and in this case as well, almost stunning, because this break provokes, that change that moving forward requires actually. I like his drawings very much. And you know, I'm not Chinese, he is not Romanian, but art has no frontiers. If the drawing is sensitive, is has meaning, has a seriousness, which his drawings do have, then you know they become universal and they could move any eye and every heart. Ningbo Historic Museum. This is probably, I don't know if still, because in this presentation, I don't have actually his latest works, maybe for the past 2 years or so, but this work is one of his most important and probably the most famous by now. It's a beautiful work, in my opinion. It is monumental, it is playful, it has this improvisational character which the so-called professional would never be able to do. This is born from love. This is born from understanding that without play, creativity cannot be. You can also see, and I'll show some other images with the inventiveness of using recycled materials. I don't know how he instructs the workers, because I cannot imagine him doing everything. No, he worked with people and he allowed them to be playful. And the result, I think, is excellent. You know, it's a building, it's an informed building. This is an educated building in the sense that he actually has a doctorate in architecture. This man who calls his office amateur architecture is a doctor in architecture. So this building is not an ignorant building of the history of architecture, the tradition of his own country. No, he's a knowledgeable man, but he allowed playfulness and spontaneity to be present. Look at the top. I mean, this cannot be done, in a premeditated way. I mean, you could suggest a strategy, but you cannot, ad literam, or look what's going on here. This kind of spontaneous intervention into the facade requires a trust in the workers you work with. And I welcome something like this, and I wish you could do this more often. Unfortunately, we are so stiff, so frightened by, the prospect of making mistakes, and also by an education which totally eliminates ornament. The very word is not used in the schools of architecture in our country. The word ornament is not present, it's taboo. But what is this? This is ornament. It's clear for all to see. This is ornament. This is the 21st century, a major architect indulging in something that maybe Adolf Loos would have protested against. Although Adolf Loos didn't mind using himself marble, very ornamental appearance in several of his projects. And even Miss van der Rohe in the pavilion, Barcelona pavilion, uses marble, highly ornamental. So, not to speak about Louis Sullivan, who said form follows function, although he was terribly misunderstood and simplistically misinterpreted, but he generated the most funambulesque ornamentation that I know of. So here is Wang Shu indulging in bringing to the facade of a monumental building the aesthetical surprise of ornamentation. Bravo to him. And we should try to do the same. Do not say no to ornament. Ornament is coming back with great force in the works of many architects. Even Patrick Schumacher said, ornament and structure should come together. And he runs the office of Zaha Hadid Architects. Look at this, this is also ornamental, but it's a different understanding of what ornament means. You, when we think of ornament, we think in a very predictable and decorative way, you know, like picking up from the history of ornamentation, some details, and, you know, indulging in, you know, copy and paste. No, this is ornamental, but it's a contemporary understanding of what ornamentation is. You know, and this fact that he was not afraid to introduce various materials of various textures, various colors, bravo to him. This is the kind of sensitivity that we need. And also, if we could recycle as much as he does, all for the better. I mean, you know, there are subtle differences that these spontaneous interventions generate. Without them, the building would be much more, well, insensitive and cold. Do you see the importance of, I mean, here we have concrete, here we have all kinds of, you know, tiles, here we have ornamentation. It's the building becomes interesting and unique exactly because of these, you know, so-called accidents. They are not accidents. I mean, it's a form of imagining architecture that is not common to us because we are so stiff. Everything we do with white walls, and we think that's it. You know, that's modern architecture. Well, maybe it was 100 years ago. But even then, it was not, because I said both Adolf Loos and Mies used marble with a very, very, very rich natural ornamentation. I like this impressionism. I think of the impressionists in painting, this impressionism of the facade, because the facade is, you know, there are a few windows here, a few openings, maybe nothing exceptional, but because of the way he covered the facade in this way, it becomes unique, it becomes sensitive. It becomes interesting. So again, I think here there are suggestions for a different kind of modernism. Not to speak about the fact that the monolithic quality of concrete is here challenged by the mixture of various styles, which creates also the tectonics of the wall are rich and complex, and you know, they are not you know, blunt. And look at this. Now, I don't know exactly, I mean, you know, yes, if you think of insulation, if you think of you know, creating a sound wall against cold and against heat, against water, I don't know, maybe he took some poetical licenses, but just like someone makes a sweater, you know, a manual sweater through embroidery, through weaving, and introduces ornaments in the act of creating the sweater or a sock or whatever, the same does the architect here. You know, it's again, I truly think this is an invitation addressed to all of us to reconsider the walls of our architecture, which are so banal most of the time, and we are only interested in space, right? Space and structure, nothing else. Well, architecture is much more than just space and structure. You know, it is important how you touch a wall. It is important how it is made, you know, the materials that it is made of. And, you know, I mean, I read the books by Palladio, the four books. He doesn't use the word space at all, nor does Alberti. I don't know about Brunelleschi, but so this obsession we have with space is because we simplified architecture in very dangerous ways. You know, so we are left with almost nothing. If we didn't have space, what would we have with our white walls? Not much. So then of course we are so interested in space. Well, also via Bruno Cevi and so on. But look at this wall. Is it not architecture? I think it's a beautiful architecture. It's a beautiful architecture where the human hand is present, where materials that are recycled are present. And you see this, you know, adding together of all these little fragments to build a wall. I think existentially speaking, this wall is much, much richer than the banal white walls of Richard Meier, let's say. Yes, he uses, well, he has concrete here that maybe Tadawan would have protested against because it's not perfect and it's not polished. But I'm very sorry, I admire Tadawan, but this wall to me is more interesting, more innovative than his polished concrete walls, eternally built. He never stops questioning those walls. So, Wang Shu, there is much to learn from him. And you see here, I don't know exactly what is happening at the frontier between these two different treatments of the wall. If there is a stair here or something, maybe yes, maybe not. I don't know, it looks maybe capricious, but why not? You know, why should we have the same texture and the same look, you know, for the whole length of the wall? Or you know, the whole, also, it's not just, I mean, I don't know about the function, but you see also the they are not in the same plane. So there is some justification here. It's not totally capricious. No, his architecture is one of the most interesting today. In my opinion, he is more radical than Rem Koolhaas. Look at this. Now, I'm absolutely sure that those who teach, you know, finishes would protest against this. What's going on here? You know, there must be something behind this covering. I don't know. But how do you make the working drawing for something like this? This was done spontaneously by workers, not by him. He was probably on the side telling them, well, feel free to be playful with the ceramic tiles that I collected. And they were. And this was exactly the strategy used by the builders of the great cathedrals in the Middle Ages. I read many times that the cathedrals were not built just by master builders. They were built by everybody, you know, even children, old people, women. They all contributed to bringing together the cathedral as quickly as possible. I know this happened at Chartres because Chartres, the cathedral of Chartres, collapsed. I mean, it was had a fire and it was destroyed. And they rebuilt it in 25 years. So the little village, or little town of Chartres in France, rebuilt Chartres Cathedral in 25 years. While New York City, which has almost 20 million people and all the money in the world and all the technology in the world, they cannot finish St. John the Divine Cathedral. Well, I know, and no cathedral is totally so-called finished, but to bring it to a level of coagulation that is approximately meaning it is finished. They can't. Why? Well, what's the difference between New York City and the Chartres, little town of Chartres? Chartres with 25,000 people, New York City with 20 million. New York City with an abundance of financial means and technology, while the village of Chartres in the 12th century, you can imagine. And yet, Chartres built one of the most splendid and miraculous cathedrals ever built, the Cathedral of Chartres, La Cathédrale de Chartres. And New York City, it can't even finish a pastiche, yes, the largest in the world, St. John the Divine, but essentially a pastiche, you know, nothing truly very original. Anyway, it has to do with faith. Well, here, these people, inspired by, I guess, what Wang Shu and his wife told them, they began to play with these ceramic tiles. And I think what they did is beautiful. I love this, just this picture. What I look at, I love it. Now, take a similar picture of almost any other work of the present, and you will not have the same richness as you have here. No, you will not have. It's really like making a sweater. You know, this fascia of the wall has something of, you know, a woven, you know, okay, let's say sweater, you know, an embroidered something, you know, where you you can see every single step of the process. It's textile work, really. It's weaving. And the word architect and architecture derive from the root text, T-E-K-S, which means to weave in the Indo-European language. All the derivations of the word architect or architecture in any language, they all trace back to that etymological root text, T-E-K-S, which in the Indo-European language meant to weave. It's textile work. In its essence, architecture is textile work. And what this is what we see here. Yes, look at this. It's like a beautiful, you know, almost abstract painting, if I am to think bidimensionally. Just look at the gentleness of, you know, trying the correct, you know, the small pieces, how these things come together. It's splendid. This, it's so much delicacy and affection just in this little fragment here, or here, or everywhere you see a care to assemble together many elements which have different sizes, different geometries, and yet they come together and they build the world. Call it an amateur wall if you want. It's a beautiful wall. And it's a great building, one of the greatest buildings of the last 25 years. I hope Wang Shu hears me and pays a visit to me here in Bucharest so we can, after the pandemic goes, or he should come now and teach us what to do so we won't have a pandemic any longer. I don't think this man is interested of having a luxurious villa at his disposal and three cars. Now, an architect who loves architecture and art and culture and ideas is not interested in such frivolous things. Now, a campus in the China Academy of Art, phases 1 and 2 in the town where he is actually living and working, from 2002 and 2007. Let's see. Very different work, are they not? Yes, they are. And very Chinese at the same time. You know, you would not have expected this work after you saw the previous one. But it shows the complexity of the man. Do you see here what I was telling you about? I don't have a picture with someone working here on this thing. I don't know really why these people work on the roof. Maybe there is also some kind of a functional, logistics, or I don't know. But Mircea Eliade probably would have loved the idea, you know, to connect vertically with with the sky, with the above. Look at this. I can talk the whole evening just about what I see here. The functionalist, and I am an intense adversary of the functionalist, would never comprehend this. The functionalist would say, what is going on here? You know, why are these, like this? You know, why aren't they horizontal? Why? What happens if you pass by this window? You can break in the apartment, or you can see something there that you are not supposed to see. Or negativity, criticism. Where did you see something like this? How can you do something like this? Well, Wang Shu, who received the Pritzker Prize, ladies and gentlemen, did it. And I think it's beautiful, okay? It is beautiful. We can just look here and see clearly that this man, is not at all seduced by the rigidities and dogmas of functionalism. And I also imagine that these people working not just on the roofs of some buildings, maybe not this one, but also on this prolonged passageway or long balcony, or how to call it, on this ramp, they learn something about the world, perhaps about themselves, about meeting other people, about what is outside, what is inside. It's a less inhibited and inhibiting relationship with the outside, with the world. As Buckminster Fuller said, the environmentalism, they are concerned with everything that is outside of us, without us, while cosmos is concerned with what is outside of us plus us. And I think, you know, this building, which is a collective building, is a public building. I mean, you know, there are individual apartments here, but so it's a collective housing complex. But with this maybe strange ramp on the facades of the building is actually proclaiming the unity of all the individual units, that there is multiplicity in unity. This capricious, because it is capricious, you know, I mean, the functionalist to say, okay, if you want to do this, do it like this several times, you know, depending on the floors that you have. Why? Because the rationalist cannot accept that playfulness is part of creativity. Well, creativity without playfulness is not creativity. It's as simple as this. Now, I know very well that the professional will ask you, how do you legitimize this architectural decision that you took? The Inquisition. The Inquisition will try you very, very harshly. How do you justify this? Why did you do it like this and not the other way around, you know? as if everything in life and in nature has a rational explanation, everything. Why did God make the tail of the peacock so splendid as it is? Or why did God make the wings of the butterfly so miraculously beautiful? Why? Why, Mr. Rationalist? Why? But the rationalist doesn't care about God, about the peacock, about the butterfly. The rationalist only thinks of his little calculations. But the rationalist will never get the Pritzker Prize, okay? And the rationalist will not be paid homage to in this series of presentations, I can assure of. I love Wang Shu. And he's very Chinese, and he's very modern, and he's very modest, and he's very audacious at the same time. Look, there is merit, you know? So what if you pass by some windows? Well, in all cities, when you pass by on the narrow sidewalk, you don't pass by windows? Of course you do. Any sidewalk passes by windows. It's known. Especially in all towns, all cities, you know, like Sibiu, where, you know, the old medieval town or the old town was built, you know, more organically, more with a quality that the present day rationalist does not have at all. A rationalist would say, why is this bigger and this smaller? Why are these windows like this and not in line? Why is this larger than this one? Why this and why that? Why this and why that? Well, Wang Shu just smile and not respond, I'm sure. I look at these beautiful oblongs. I hope you are beginning to understand why he received the Pritzker, because he's excellent, that's why. Look at the building on the right, which is also by him. What is going on with these openings in the concrete wall? Why are they like this? Are you crazy? Are you irresponsible? Why didn't you make them straight? The rationalist and the functionalist would ask. Again, Wang Shu would just smile and not respond. Or this opening, why is it like this and not the other way around? You know, with the big thing on the right and the small thing on the left. Because that's how he wanted it to be, that's why. Okay, look at this. It's magnificent. I really think it is. Sculptural, plastic art, right? Art, well, what would architecture be if it is not also an art? Vertical courtyard apartments, 2002, 2007. This is a different kind of work. These are, you know, blocks of flats, tall. But even here, you see this weaving, the fragmentation that generates the whole from smaller parts. And I still think that these are, I of course, I know he's Chinese, and I know that this work was built in China. But I do believe they have something Chinese. There is as the French saying goes, a quelque chose. There is something about this building. I never traveled to China, but I see something Chinese here, maybe a pagoda, a tall pagoda, like there are so many beautiful ones in deserted little villages. I have a beautiful book from 1920s done in Germany with China, Baukunst und Landschaft. Great, great, great images of old, very old villages, and almost each one of them has a beautiful pagoda. Well, this is an apartment building, but has something somehow of a pagoda. I mean, if you compare his work with this one, you see a big difference. Yes, there is the modern China with an impetus in building, which is colossal, but somehow Wang Shu and his wife, they together create an architecture which sends a subtle, since I ventured a little bit in French, clin d'oeil towards the past. Towards the culture of their own country. Clin d'oeil means in French, se trache cu ocul, you know, a little metaphor for, having some attention towards what preceded you. These are the plans. So I hope I have, let me see. Yeah, I have here a better picture of the plans. I think they are excellent. They are both rational and irrational. I think they function well, the apartments. They have a, it's a geometric layout, but also it's somehow slightly organic. For blocks of flats, I think is, and I imagine each floor, or at least each two floors, they become a little bit different. So there is a movement here, you know. Again, you know, someone would protest here. What's going on here? This is so narrow here. What do you do there? As if we have to do something in every square inch. No, it's not like this. Or look here, you know, again, the rationalist and the functionalist would protest, would say, what is going on? This you don't use here. You don't, as if we have to use everything, you know, as if everything has to have an usage, you know, a rationalist usage. Or look here, what's this little space here? Is it not a loss? Of course it is, Mr. Rationalist and Mr. Dogmatist and Mr. Functionalist. Here too, look. But the people who offered him the Pritzker Prize didn't care about these things. You know, they cared about the wholeness of his work. And what can we say? So you see the sections through the building are rational. Yes, it's possible that they were not more expensive than other buildings of this, height. So let's read, at each level of the building allows for alternating courtyards and balcony spaces. Each unit has one or the other, and they alternate up the entire height of the building. The extruded envelope that encapsulates the courtyard also provides coverage for the balcony spaces and vice versa. It's a rational work, but it's not only rational. So, you know, like a good architecture, certain decisions were made in the name of other reasons than the functionalist ones or the measurable ones. And look at this building, you know, it's, why did he complicate matters here? You know, that's how the functionalist would say. Why, what are these complications here? What's going on here? Well, let's read. This subtle shifting of planes allows for every apartment to have either a covered courtyard or balcony. The shift occurs between the floor plate of one unit and the ceiling of another, creating a beautiful overlapping detail within the structure. And you see it here. Good architecture is always some kind of a complication. Art itself is a complication. You know, the human beings, well, let's call them the human beings who only eat and sleep and watch TV, they think that art is a complication. Poetry is a complication. Philosophy is a complication. Everything is a complication for the man who doesn't want to feel and doesn't want to think. He only wants to eat and sleep and have a car and run on the highway without creating anything, actually. Now look here, look at this complexity here. It's an event right here in this corner. Again, the rationalist would protest, would say, this is nonsense. I will not have it, you know. Why don't you make it straight, sir? But why, is life straight? Is this tree straight? You could say there are some hesitations here, but these hesitations, if we are to call them so, express a certain sensitivity. And sensitivity, yes, is important, even in architecture. Look at the drawings. I didn't see working drawings by him, but I only saw handmade sketches. Now, this house from 2003, what can I say? It's very Chinese somehow. Don't ask me why I say this, because I don't actually know. I it's a feeling I have. It's very Chinese. This monumental roof is, you know, some might say it's crushing the house. Maybe to an extent, but it's still a different kind of aesthetics, having to do with the culture of the place. What is this ladder doing here? I don't know, but I'm happy it is there. Look at that tree there, which breaks the roof. Maybe a little bit questionably, it's possible. He also created some houses that are, you know, for, you know, like experimental houses. And it might be that this is one of them. Again, ornamentation, yes, the taboo world. This is ornament, clearly. Why are we afraid of this world? I don't know. But this is also ornament in the tree. The flowers in the spring, the leaves. And the man is dreaming, of course. Maybe he will write a poem. The Chinese had in the past great emperors who cultivated calligraphy and poetry. But today, you know, it's hard for us to imagine something like this, that a political leader was doing calligraphy and, you know, writing poetry. This is how, and I'm sure there are books like this that you can purchase soon on the edge, on the side, you know, in a traditional way, and, you know, with his drawings. Ceramic house, because I told you he collects a lot of ceramic, and not just ceramic materials, from demolitions. He complained severely against the erasing overnight of countless villages in China, the leveling of mountains in the name of progress. You can find on the web interviews with him and you know, conferences. This house to me is not, is a little bit, is rigid. I mean, I appreciate the fact that he, you know, used ceramic tiles that he had in his, I almost said archive, but the house is, I don't know, for my taste, a little bit less free than everything we saw previously, but I like the usage of these materials for, you know, for the horizontal surfaces and also for the fence. And also here, because you have also this weaving that I mentioned before. It's just that the geometry of the house is rather rigid. But he's, after all, a modern architect. Maybe that's why Kenneth Frampton called him an enigma, because certain parts of his work are more close to what we call tradition or the past, and others less. Five scattered houses. I like the word scattered, because scattered means unplanned. We already saw, I'm a little bit confused, because he builds in various contexts and certain things are, I mean, there are existing buildings around, but for example, this presentation board was not done by him, I think, was done either by maybe his students or other people to show how certain buildings that he envisioned came into being. Here we see indeed details, constructive details, but this was not done, I think, in his office. You see, sketch by the author, but these things, I don't know if they are by the author. And they are computer drawings, yes. Anyway, he is the subject of a lot of interest. And by the way, this man, Wang Shu, he teaches also at a very interesting school in Taiwan, perhaps the most radical and the most romantic school in the world. It's called the Ruin Academy. Can you believe it? The Ruin Academy. Please check it out on the web. You'll see the building where they not only study, but also live. And the founder is a Finnish architect of Italian origin and a very interesting architect. And Wang Shu is invited to teach there. There are interesting things happening in other countries than those we normally associate with experimentation and innovation. The Ruin Academy. Well, in a way, this fragmentation of the wall, even if it's just a fascia, just a second layer, on top of maybe the concrete wall, also refer somehow to what we call ruin, to the passage of time. After all, these things are done with found objects, with ceramic tiles, with stones, with bricks, from demolitions, most of them. So they don't look alarmingly new. They seem to have a prior life, to have had a prior life. Yeah, these drawings are not his. Anyway, now the tile garden in Venice, the Venice Biennial. Now, in my opinion, this work, I don't know exactly what his point was, what point he tried to make. In my opinion, he didn't act in a very sustainable way because he sent by ship a large quantity of roof tiles to Venice in 2006. Now in 2006, it's true, the world didn't yet start to talk seriously about what we call sustainability. Anyway, here he is together with a younger man, building this, almost horizontal roof with the typical walking on top of it, as I just mentioned. And but when I think about the immense effort to send these things from China to Venice to build a roof on earth, on grass, maybe he wanted to give the visitors to the Venice Biennial the experience of walking on top of a sloping roof. But I find it a little bit problematic that these tiles were brought to Venice with great expenditure and effort. Anyway, they did it. It's the Venice Biennial. There are all kinds of eccentric and exotic gestures in the name of showing certain things. But it is kind of questionable to build a roof of these dimensions directly on Earth, even more problematic, as I said, is the fact that he shipped these things by ship from China. They are from China. So anyway, it was done. The models of Frank Gehry that were shipped from San Francisco to New York when the retrospective took place with Frank Gehry's works at the Guggenheim Museum, which I saw, the cost just of shipping those models was for 8 million $8 million, I read in a newspaper. Anyway, I guess our world can afford it. Forget about the millions of people who have nothing to eat, right? We spend a fortune to bring ceramic tiles from China to Venice for another show. Okay, I guess we need shows too, but there is a but. When there are so many people who have nothing to eat and we spend money, in my opinion, not always very wisely. I myself don't spend the little I have wisely, so I shouldn't criticize anything. The old town conservation of Zhongshan Street in the same town in Hang Shu, 2007-2009, I love these buildings. They are so idiosyncratic, you know. How come the Chinese who had the most stringent and rigid, deadly so communism, is able now to build such things? How? It's a mystery. I mean, in just a few years, essentially, they changed dramatically. Yes, they still have, because it's a dual political and social system. But in terms of architecture and experimentation, they are what Japan was after the Second World War, and not any longer, unfortunately, as it was illustrated even this year by that stadium built by Ken Gokuma, much less innovative than the winner of that competition, that is Zaha Hadid. Anyway, I love these buildings. Look at these things which would exasperate any professor of architecture. Why did he do it like this? Why did you do it like this? Please behave. That's what. Look at this. Why did he do it like this? You know? And my answer would be, why not? Why not? But look at the tree. It's like asking God, why didn't he make this perfectly vertical and perpendicular on the earth and without these crazy branches, right? Because they are crazy. They don't follow, you know, the Cartesian rules and regulations. Ay, 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 ay. Okay, look at the roof here. Another rebelliousness. Another special structure, and we are going to see that roof soon more in detail. But look at this house, you know, asserting its freedom. Yes, asserting its freedom. Why not? And I love oblongs. I really think students and architects should use oblongs. They are nice. They are made of wood. They block off the noise. They have many qualities, oblongs, and they create also an animation on the facades, which is aesthetically, I think, very pleasing. Another, you know, craziness by Wang Shu. Let's call it craziness. I did it humorously because it's not craziness. It's life. It's look at the tree and look at the building. It's fine. It's fine, it's creative. Yeah, this is his too, but here, not everything it was by him, but this is. And we are going to look more in detail at this so-called crazy roof, which again, the functionalist and the rationalist would strongly condemn as he or she would condemn this building. You know, well, you know, there are losses of energy here, you know, everywhere, here and at the top, and then you have to climb this stair for many steps and you could get tired and, yes, of course, you can always criticize something based on, you know, on an excessive negativity. Exhibition hall of the Imperial Street of Southern Song Dynasty in the same town, and you see now the roof. And you are going to see also more in detail, this roof is actually very interesting and very creative. Unfortunately, yes, it used a lot of wood, but what can you do? You know, I mean, you could do abstain from building, but this is not easily done by, especially by architects who want to build and build and build, although the most sustainable way of building is not building. That's the most sustainable. But of course, to talk about not building to architects is like to tell them to get rid of the oxygen that they need for their lungs. Anyway, a good woodwork for the roof, and you see it is expressed towards the outside, and is this interstitial space between the usable buildings and the roof. This interstitial space, in my opinion, is very interesting and very useful for the rationalist and the functionalist who ask for unplanned activities, sir. Yes, for unplanned activities. Do we need to plan everything? I don't think so. Allow for certain spaces to be open to unplanned activities. Those usually, exactly those in between spaces, are the most interesting. Because those spaces invite the passers-by or the people who happen to be there to use their imagination. You allow them a degree of freedom. If you plan for everything, there will be no freedom on the side of the user. But here it is. You know, this place could be used for various things. Let the people who live there decide for themselves. Now, of course, again, the rationalist and the functionalist would protest, would say, so much work for this woodwork. My God, why do it? Why not make a flat roof once and for all? And that's it. Well, you know, I mean, even human beings have coiffures, have hair, no? And certain people find a great interest in, you know, having a certain coiffure. You know, the top of the of anything should have a different character. It's the same with the buildings. If the buildings, they all end with a flat, you know, flat terrace, well, I think it would be very boring, and it is very boring. Look what's going on here. Yes, it's very complex. It required a lot of work and a lot of wood, but beauty is demanding. What can we say? And look, those people love to discover. They walk up the stair. It's eventful, you know. It's an architecture which is conceived as an adventure. It becomes eventful and stirs up the imagination of the people who use them. Pavilion in Shanghai Expo 2010. Look at this. Again, why are these openings like this and not some other way? Well, you know, I like it very much, I confess. I showed this picture before. I say the same thing, I like it very much. And yes, it's a box, but it's a box with surprises, with strange openings. Why not? And again, you know, his signature by now of employing all kinds of tiles, which towards the top, again, towards the top, become more ornamental and more capricious and more free. A ladder here again. Yeah, well, I guess the Chinese love to climb on things, you know, to arrive at the top of the building so they can work on top of the roof. Interesting and strange. I like it, actually. I almost said, I wish I was Chinese. Look at this, old architecture, right? Old architecture. But what we see in this wall, we also see in his walls. You know, it's a wall made up of small pieces, one above the other. What can I say? There are so-called imperfections, but they are a sign of life. And again, drawings by him, handmade and very beautiful, I would say. Sensitive and yet descriptive, with numbers, with some dimensional quotations. And here is again a mixture of his interventions and old buildings. The old villages of China are immensely interesting and potentially, what China has, I don't know if there is any other country in the world, because they have hundreds of thousands of villages with an enormous capacity to inform architecture and culture in general. You see here, a building deserted, and you see some interventions by the Pritzker Prize laureate without insulting the context, with small interventions, but which show again care, affection for an urban context which has character, even if it was, there are cracks and there is misuse or abandonment. It's okay, it's part of life. Here is an older man, he's alive, still alive. The buildings are still alive, even if hurt. They are wounded. This one was wounded. This one is wounded. It's okay. The new architect brings new life into this context and brings new roofs, a little bit wild, maybe a little bit too ostentatious, maybe a little bit, but architecture, if it is to innovate, it has to. This is a drawing, actually, a digital modeling, not done by Wang Shu, but done, I think, at Yale University in the United States. They try to understand and to visualize, to model a fragment of his of the roof, of a roofing system that he invented or created. Yes, it's complex. Maybe it has a complexity which was not so-called required, but a bus stop in Krumbach in Austria. This village in Austria invited some important architects from the world, from various countries, to build a bus stop. And this is what he built. A very modest shelter. Again, the functionalist and the rationalist would say, no way, you cannot do this. What's this? What is this nonsense? Well, this so-called nonsense, sir, is the choice, emotional and otherwise, of one of the most important architects today. Okay, please allow him to be playful here in the corner of this modest shelter. Don't judge him, please. And don't place here stupid, commonplace vertical column, don't do it. Allow him to be amateur, okay? Meaning a lover of architecture and a lover of life. After all, architecturally speaking and aesthetically speaking, this is the most interesting of the part of the shelter. And I think it's fine. If this means that he is an enigma, let him be an enigmatic architect. Now, we're approaching the end of this presentation. The Heiyun Culture and Leisure Centers in this place, Kunming. Another interesting building. When I made this presentation, I had only a few images. I wish I had more, and I will promise that in the future, when I will present his work, I will have more images on this work, because I think it's good. Look at this building. It's a single building, but each floor is different from the others, and it's architecturally expressed differently. There is this richness. You know, it's not a rigid system. It's not a rationalist building. It's a building which is alive. Let's put it this way: it's alive. And again, the banished ornament, because we have ornamentation here. Yes, geometrical. We have ornamentation here. Yes, rhythmical. We have ornamentation here. We have ornamentation. Even the windows on this floor, which are large, they are playful. So there is a woven quality that this building has, in my opinion. And the trees, even without leaves, I think are sympathetic and smile. I like the building. Because when you weave, you bring music to architecture. And I see something musical here. And now this museum, which started in 2017, but I think it was finalized by now, but I just have a few images with walking on the roof, look at them. They are working on the roof. Well, not directly on the sloping roof, but on this, bridge, if we are to call it so. That why would they do this? You know, I don't know, but I like it. I like this idea to take the human being out of the predictability of just taking the elevator to a certain floor and quickly entering the apartment. Here, you know, you are experiencing the building in various ways, in surprising ways, and if you have a companion, all for the better. I think architecture could invent even different ways of living. And we just need courage. We need inventiveness. We need creativity. And we need non-conformism. That's what it is. So yes, the roofs are like this, but you have, you have the possibility to also have steps, stairs, and to work with someone or alone. Yeah, look at the roof. I hope the roofs are not leaking because of this. It's also like working on the mountain or on a hill. When you go home, you return from work, and you know, before you arrive to your apartment, you just walk a little bit up and down on the architectural hill that or mound that Wang Shu and venue built. Nicer than what we see here, these buildings here, because Mircea Eliade was perhaps right when he said, brisez le toit de ta maison, break the roof of your building. Wang Shu didn't break the roof, but made this possible, possible, impossible. I don't know, I have to decide, possible or impossible or both. Walking, I wonder how, I don't know, maybe there is somewhere a vertical connection with an elevator. I don't know, but it seems that people walk sometimes for a certain length to arrive wherever they want to arrive. And maybe this passage, passage of ritual of initiation almost, because it is this transitional walking between the destination and another destination, between the apartment and wherever you go, to the market or to work. And this climbing and a city, a modern city, usually doesn't allow you to do this sort of thing. You go straight home on a flat, street, and you leave the car in the parking and you take the elevator and you disappear at a certain floor. Here, a new dimension is introduced, you know, walking, simply walking, and with a lot of sky above you. And I think that's just fine. And a work in progress. These are the last images of what I show tonight. Is a museum he is building, and I think he finished it. This also looks very interesting and enticing with these narrow spaces, with these rifts between the buildings, with the diagonals of circulations, probably. Very interesting. And also, you know, not really divorced from you know, other buildings. I don't know if he built this one, probably not. So it's a museum, but it's a museum which doesn't have two lions at the entrance and white Doric columns, or I'm sarcastic, of course. It's a modest museum, but it's full of life, even from this image that I look at. Thank you and happy birthday, Wang Shu.